Before we get started, I'd just like a show of hands. How many people, is this your first trip to Alamo Pintado? Handful. No, that's good. Yeah. Well, it's. I always say it's nice to see people here when you don't have your horse, and this is an opportunity for us to all get together without writing you a bill. So this is sort of a general topic that we're going to talk about today. How to keep your horse healthy. It's sort of based on the old adage that an ounce of prevention is worth a pound of cure. And we have to ask ourselves a question: what do our horses mean to us? And horses are what bring us all together today. You know, whether it be a performance horse, a breeding animal, something you use for pleasure, or just a companion. And of course, there's a lot of crossover with that as well. Some of these horses fulfill all of those requirements or needs in our lives. Talk a little bit about vaccines. This is, like I say, a fairly general topic that they gave me to talk about. We're going to talk about vaccines a little bit. The AEP has established what we consider core vaccines for horses should be given annually. The encephalitises, tetanus, rabies, and West Nile are what we consider our core vaccines for our horses. And break it down a little bit further, we'd like to talk a little bit more about rabies. We've seen a huge increase worldwide in the incidence of rabies in our mammalian species. Rabies is the one disease that is what we call zoonotic. So your horse potentially could give you rabies, just like your dog. So we want to make sure, from a human health standpoint, that we are protected for rabies with our horses and, of course, your, you know, dogs and cats and those sorts of things. Any domestic livestock can carry rabies. So we do recommend that your horses are vaccinated for rabies. Public health, we see animals that are positive for rabies on the Central Coast every year. So it's something to consider when we're vaccinating our horses. And your veterinarian is the only one that can actually administer a rabies shot. So that gives you an opportunity, you know, at least once a year to touch base with your veterinarian and go ahead and get a rabies shot for your horse. West Nile virus, kind of a big one, first appeared in the United States in 1999. It came from the West Nile Valley in Africa or in Egypt. And spread by mosquitoes. Birds are the reservoir for that. So, you know, you hear about bird die-offs with West Nile. When it first came into the United States, that was sort of the sentinel sign that we had West Nile in an area. We don't see a whole lot of it in this particular area because we don't have a heavy load of mosquitoes, although we do occasionally see some cases that come through, especially in years past. The vaccine is very effective, especially the newer vaccines. So it's a very preventable disease at this point in time. It can look like a lot of different things, neurologic signs. Sometimes the horses will look a little bit colicky with it as well. But it does have a fairly high mortality rate associated with it in unvaccinated horses. So that's one that we would definitely want to vaccinate for once a year. Tetanus, you know, obviously one of the oldest diseases that we are aware of in horses. It's a very fatal disease in horses. Here again, the vaccine's very effective. In my 30 years of practice, I've probably seen 8 to 10 horses with tetanus, and the majority of them did not make it. So that's one that, you know, we definitely want to vaccinate for. It is included in most all of our combination vaccines. It's also, while not transmittable from horse to human, it's one that's in the environment. So, you know, if you're in and around horse facilities and whatnot, you have a cut on your finger, that sort of thing, it's definitely important that you get to the hospital and get a tetanus vaccine. Encephalomyelitis, here again, spread by mosquitoes. You see a little bit about this in the press, eastern encephalomyelitis in humans. Here again, not transmittable from your horse, but birds are the reservoir for that, and the vector, once again, is mosquitoes. Vaccine is very effective for horses, and that's part of your annual core vaccine that we'd like to give to our horses. Risk-based vaccines outside the realm of the core vaccines, influenza or flu, herpes virus, streptococcus, strangles vaccine, crinibacterium, especially in our area, California. This is a vaccine that's been available now for the last couple of years through your veterinarian. And we've had an opportunity to use it in our practice last couple of years, and at least in my hands, it's been very effective. And I encourage anyone that's interested in a dryland vaccine to have your veterinarian come out and talk with you about that. Rhinitis A, there's a vaccine that's being developed for that. Similar type thing to herpes and influenza. Potomac horse fever, obviously something that's an East Coast problem around the Potomac River. If you've got a horse, say, that's competing on the East Coast, you might talk to your veterinarian about possibly vaccinating for that. EPM vaccine, here again, we don't use a whole lot of that. More of a Kentucky, Texas issue, East Coast, and that vaccine isn't probably as effective as some of the other ones that we're going to talk about today. Just to break things down a little bit, equine influenza is a real common disease in horses. It's one that we see at a lot of shows, especially with young horses that are traveling and where there's a high density of horses that are stable together. It's economically important. High morbidity, meaning it's very contagious, and low mortality. We don't see horses necessarily succumb to influenza, but we do see high temperatures, and it can lead to other problems with your horses. Just like with kids, things can start off as a virus, but then we'll lead into some of our bacterial issues that can be more severe and significant for your horse. Vaccine is very effective. We definitely recommend it for young show horses and also people that are traveling to and from shows or competitions on a regular basis. Outbreaks are common, and as we said, can lead to more serious respiratory issues. The antigen drift for equine influenza is actually quite slow. So unlike, say, our human influenza or flu, where they're updating the vaccine on a yearly basis, the antigen drift or the change of the virus itself is quite slow for horses. So that gives us the benefit of having vaccines that are effective over a longer period of time as far as their constituents that are included in them. Equine herpes virus, you know, that's one that scares everybody quite commonly. It is what they call the Trojan horse of equine diseases. There's many different types. This is the one where we have the outbreaks, and it can be quite fatal, the neurologic form of it. There is no vaccine for that per se, but we do recommend that obviously you're up to date on your herpes vaccinations. Vaccine is effective in reducing signs and transmission, but it's not necessarily going to be 100%. Direct horse-to-horse contact, this is the one that, you know, where we have our big quarantines and it shuts everything down, the neurologic form of it. Take-home message on vaccines. Veterinarians are trained to evaluate vaccines, and so it's real important that you consult with your veterinarian when you institute a vaccine program. We have most of the companies give us a warranty on the vaccine, so if there's ever a horse that's vaccinated that breaks with the disease, they'll cover the costs associated with diagnosis and treatment, most of the good vaccine companies, but only if it's administered by a veterinarian. Access to relevant strains of influenza, we talked a little bit about that. There are a number of vaccines that you'll get at the feed stores that are outdated or have been sitting on the shelf, and we don't recommend that you typically purchase those and use those on your horses. We prefer that you stay updated and like I say, consult your veterinarian to administer those if you can. Talking a little bit about worming now, we do recommend that all horses be wormed. It seems like, you know, we go up and down with worming schedules with horses, and I hear that a lot from clients. Well, I don't worm, I just do fecals on my horses. Dr. Teske talked a little bit about the fact that even if we have a negative fecal exam on a horse, we very well could still have a parasite problem, because the life stage of these parasites is such that they aren't necessarily shedding eggs, and we see a negative fecal but still have a parasite problem. So it's important that you're on some sort of a schedule with your worming. We also see certain eggs, tapeworms in particular, that are transmitted through the hay. So it's not necessarily a case where your horse is all by itself somewhere in a paddock and not exposed to parasites. They can come in your feed sources. So it's important that we worm our horses routinely. Dental care, recommend all horses be checked once a year, starting at a year of age. It's probably the leading cause of colic, one of the leading causes of colic, weight loss, of course, and decreased performance. So especially through their performance years, when they're losing caps and their teeth are changing, it's very important that they have a good dental exam and be floated on a routine basis. General area of concern, this is sort of probably going to generate more questions than answers, but we'd like to have our horses in a safe environment. And you always hear people say, gosh, these horses can get hurt anywhere. Well, they can. They're big kids. But make sure your paddocks are in good repair. We don't have nails. We don't have wires sticking out. We don't have broken boards. I'm thinking about my own place right now. How safe is it? Security, we want to make sure our gates are shut. Growing up on a ranch, that was always a big thing. You know, if you walk out of a paddock, make sure you shut the gate, even if there isn't a horse in it. We don't want horses out on highways. We don't want horses running free by swimming pools. So security is a big issue. Access to feed and water seems like a simple thing, but, the power goes out. The water district shuts off the pipeline and you're unaware of it. And water tanks become dry very quickly, especially in the heat in the summer. And horses need to have access to water. Kids said they fed the horses, but they didn't. It's not just kids, but it's important that we follow up with those things. Supplements, vitamins, minerals, joint considerations. You see the Platinum Performance there. We're partial, obviously, to that product, but horses should have access to the minerals and vitamins that they need. And as Lisa talked a little bit, and Tyler, joint considerations, things we can do to prevent our horses from getting soreness and lameness issues. Protected from the elements. Fortunately, this part of California, we don't have huge issues with that. Sometimes in the wintertime when we have heavy rainfall, we do see horses that have skin issues. So it's not a bad idea, at least in this part of California, maybe a waterproof blanket, some sort of cover during the wintertime if we do have heavy rainfall. The cold isn't necessarily much of an issue here. Heat can be an issue, especially for younger horses. So a little bit of cover and just awareness of what the temperature is. So heat and water are probably the two big things that we deal with in this part of California. What's normal look like? This is sort of a general slide, but in general, your horse should drink somewhere between 5 and 10 gallons of water daily, and consume 15 to 20 pounds of roughage or feed daily. Be aware of their manure output. We have colics come in, and that's probably one of the first questions I'll ask people is, how much manure do you pass? Is there a change in the consistency of the manure? Is it firmer? Is it softer? Know what normal looks like so that you recognize abnormal. So urine production, same basic thing. Routine grooming, that's just a really good idea to kind of know where the bumps and the swellings and the heat and the, you know, different things to your horse that are normal, so you recognize when something changes. Daily observations, what's his attitude look like? Is he running a temperature? Everybody ought to at least have a thermometer and have an ability to sort of take their horse's temperature periodically if they've got a question. How's he eating? Is he sweating normally? All those things that you observe normally with your horse. That kind of concludes what I had to present to you today. And this is a famous quote that I like by Ronald Reagan. I've often said there's nothing better for the inside of a man than the outside of a horse.